it's a paper on stochastic dominance. You know that, if you are in this room, you're interested in economic theory, I guess, you know that there is a large literature on dominance analysis for implementing poverty comparison, inequality comparison, social welfare comparisons. And the idea is that we don't really know what are the right indicators for this concept, what is the right poverty index, what would be the right inequality index. But we would like to, we have some ideas about the property of these indicators, and we would like to reach a robust judgment for a set of indicators on which we would agree, although we don't know exactly which one to use. These techniques are based on the fact that we are able to introduce assumptions on the norms which should be suggestions to the definition of this poverty, inequality, social welfare indicators. There is a big literature on income distribution, which is quite old, with papers in the beginning of the 19th century in the math literature. And the kind of normative hypotheses which are used are various properties about aversion to inequality. Typically, one likes to say perhaps that the social welfare would be represented by the maximization of a sum of utilities in a utilitarian framework, and these utilities will be concave, which represents some aversion to inequality by the social planner. In multidimensional settings, which is here the topics of this paper, the literature is much more recent, but it's growing. It's less obvious how to obtain multi-powerful rules, powerful comparison rules. What do I mean by multidimensional setting? I mean, you want to do some welfare comparison, social welfare comparison, between countries, between periods, before and after the policy, and you have several dimensions. Health, for example, if you are interested in health, income, education, whatever you want to put, which would contribute to the social welfare. So it's less obvious to obtain powerful rules. That is the theorem that we have. Generally, when you take some actual data, are going to be such that you cannot conclude that one situation is more unequal or the social welfare in one situation is better than in another one. So what people do in this literature is that they impose the normative restrictions, such as this inequality aversion, by using signs of derivative of utilities. So inequality aversion would be the second derivative of the utility would be negative. When you have several attributes of welfare, you would use partial utility derivatives. And to make the comparison more powerful, it's good to have more conditions. And people have climbed the degrees of conditions. So first order derivatives, second order derivatives, third order derivatives have been used. Fourth order derivatives have not much been used, and that's what we are going to do in this paper. Right. So what I'm doing in this paper is first I introduce a new way to incorporate normative restriction in welfare analysis. This is important because the result, the mathematics which come behind, will be just the translation of this hypothesis on your social welfare comparison problem. And I'm going to introduce the notion of welfare shock sharing, and you see how, by using this new notion, it's easy to characterize some sign of derivative of utilities. And that's going to help me to provide normative interpretation of fourth degree derivative of utilities. For example, here, there is a utility function, and you have the partial derivative where you derived three times with respect to the first attribute, and once with respect to the second attribute, and you assume that this is negative. When it's written like that, it looks really mysterious. Why should you do this kind of assumption? But if you are able to justify this kind of assumption, you'll be able to use them to generate more powerful theorem of stochastic dominance. And that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to present new, necessary, and sufficient conditions for stochastic dominance for several classes of utilities, and with their poverty ordering equivalent characterization. So we have really a short time, so I'm going to jump over the notation. We have an utilitarian framework. We compare the social welfare with a joint distribution of two attributes, X and Y, say it's income and health, for example, with another joint distribution. Problems with that? Okay. Here, and we would like to know if the situation with this joint distribution of income and health in F is better than this one, and that would be the case if the difference of social welfare is positive. So we just want to know if social welfare has improved when moving from F star to F. The problem is that we don't know the utility. Nobody has seen the utility around, so we don't know this utility function. There are cardinal utilities in this setting, but perhaps we can agree on some conditions. We can agree that the welfare of people, the well-being of people, is going to increase with their income and on with their health. We can agree that there would be some inequality aversion in income, inequality to the correlation of income and health. These are typical conditions. There are also some third-order conditions, partial utilities, which are supposed to be positive, which have been developed recently. For example, I use them in one JET paper by justifying that it corresponds to some compensation, that people would be happy to compensate for some bad health, some people. But this has been used in the literature. What we are going to try to add are these 4 degrees utility. For the 4 degrees partial derivative of utilities, so I need to make sense of that. Ah, it's not working. Okay, it's blocked. Right. So, to make sense of this partial derivative, I introduce the notion of welfare shock sharing. And the idea is to try to put more flesh on the idea of solidarity of society against social shocks. So a simple way to do it is that you have 2 individuals. They are completely identical. They have the same endowment. And what should be the welfare effect, the social welfare effect, on some welfare shocks on this small society? So what are the welfare shocks? They can be fixed losses. There can be risk affecting, random risk affecting some attributes. There can be other things that I'm not going to develop in this paper. I'm going to simply focus on losses, on risk for the moment. And I'm going to provide application to social welfare functions, which are additive in individual utilities, for example, when individual welfare is represented by expected utility. Let's take an example. So we have 2 individuals. With 2 attributes, X and Y, and they may suffer shocks. They may be fixed losses. C and D may be fixed losses. Epsilon and delta may be center real random variable, which are independent together. And I say that a social planner is welfare correlation averse if the society, the small society where initially 2 persons had the same endowment in income and health, now the small society where they share the shocks, you know, you have 2 shocks, they lose C, the first person loses C here in the first attribute and D in the second attribute. This is preferred by the social planner to the society where the same person would suffer all the shocks. That is, sharing fixed losses affecting different attributes improve social welfare. Okay? Right. So I can, like that, define other notion. I would say that the social planner is welfare prudent if sharing a fixed loss here on the center risk here affecting the first attribute, say income, improves social welfare. I call that welfare prudent. I call a social planner welfare cross prudent if the random shocks affects a different attribute than the fixed loss, but still sharing the fixed loss on the center risk affecting different attributes improves social welfare. This is what I call welfare course prudent. I can define social planners which are welfare temperate when they think that sharing center risk affecting the same first attribute improves social welfare. You see here, this small society of two persons is preferred to this one because the same different persons are going to suffer the shocks as compared to here, the concentration on the shocks on the same individual. And finally, I say that the social planner is welfare cross-temporate if sharing center risk affecting different attributes improves social welfare. So for all these notions, the intuition is really easy to convey because it's about we are sharing shocks, it's good in a society to share shocks. And that would correspond to notions which are not so different in a risk analysis. Now it's possible to extend this by defining, for example here, the notion of that the social welfare is said to be welfare premium correlation averse, so it's a big word. What does it mean? It means that sharing fixed losses affecting different attributes improves social welfare, while less so under background risk in the first attribute. Wow, that looks a little bit complex to perceive at the first time, but if we look at it carefully, it's just said that you prefer this society to this one. Here you have four individuals. They have two attributes. If you just look at these two individuals there, they are going to share the shocks. So sharing shocks, we have call it correlation aversion, is good for society. Sharing shock is good. You prefer this small society of 2% to this one. But this one, they do the opposite. They concentrate the shocks under a background risk of epsilon. So why is it that globally you prefer this society to this one? Because the background risk here, if you adopt as, for example, a welfare individual criterion, which is the expected utility, this is going to be to smooth the curvature of your indirect utility, and you'll be less sensitive to the same losses for people who have already a background risk than here. Okay, so first stage, it's possible to define these different notions, normative notions. Second stage, it's possible to translate them in a theorem into derivative conditions, partial derivative conditions. So inequality aversion is equivalent to this well-known condition that the second derivative in the utility is negative, and you can, like that, generate all the derivative conditions that you want, up to the last one, which looks really weird in the beginning. Now we understand that it corresponds to welfare premium correlation aversion. This one corresponds to welfare cross-temperance, the fact that you are ready to, you prefer to share random shocks. Okay? So that's something which is natural when you say it like that, I prefer a society where people share random shocks, it can be translated by this partial derivative condition. Okay, I don't show the proof, I don't have time to show all this proof. This is the last one, which I would like to comment, but I won't have time, I guess, to do the comment of this new. This is a new condition. This has never been used in anywhere in the economic large. So let's move to the result of stochastic dominance. Stochastic dominance takes, look at the function g. This is going to be the function u, the utility that we are interested in. I can define some classes of function by looking at, it's not very well written here, but this is the partial derivative where you derive k1 times with respect to the first argument and k2 times with respect to the second argument. And you multiply by a sign which corresponds to the sign that you want to implement in economics in general for the derivative of utility. So this condition of sign on this function g is implemented for various values of k1 and k2, and these values of k1 and k2 are simply k1 equals 0 to s1 and k2 equals 0 to s2. These functions which satisfy this condition are called s1, s2 increasing concave. Okay. Now you can also define the another class of function, which is the S increasing directionally concave function with S a natural number, an integer. And that is the same condition, except that the value of k1 and k2 are slightly different. Why do I say that? Because I can take advantage of asymptotic expansion for these functions, which will give me the generators of this set of functions. These set of functions are convex codes. So they can be completely summarized by their generators, and I can find the generators for this. A few definitions that you know well. This is the distribution function for the first argument, say income. So this is the integral, the term that you use in second order stochastic dominance. If you do the integral a third time, let's call it L. This is going to be the third order stochastic dominance, univariate the stochastic dominance, fourth order, etc. So usual notations. Now, instead of taking the integral of F, you can take the integral of the joint distribution. I call it H. Or you can take this integral, okay, here the integral is with respect to the two arguments, or you can take it only with respect to one argument. I call it hx, if you do it twice, lx, if I do it twice, nx. Okay, just a question that I need to state theorems. So now for some set of functions, which most of them are new in the literature, I'll be able to derive theorems of stochastic dominance. We can start with a set of functions which is known in literature. You have all the first order, second order condition. You have this condition for third order derivative or first order derivative. This was proposed by Atkinson and Bourguignon, and they have derived these conditions as sufficient conditions. Now we have the proof as necessary and sufficient condition. So these are well known, but this set of functions is a bit weird because why would you have only this third order condition or not U111, U222, and why you need this one and not the other one? So it has not really been used in the literature because also people didn't know what was the meaning of this condition here. Now we understand that it can be justified by an axiom of sharing of random shocks in a society. This is another class of utilities which can be useful when you believe that the second attribute is ordinal. You can't give a cardinal meaning to the second attribute. In that case, you can define the sign of the variation of utility with respect to U, but you cannot define the curvature. So that's why you have only a limited set of conditions that you can assume in that case. And I provide the stochastic integral condition to say that there is welfare dominance, social welfare dominance for this class of utility. This is just the fourth order stochastic dominance univariate, which is already known for a long time. I just remind it so that you can see the notation. In that case, this is first order. This is not used empirically. This has not been used empirically so far because people have difficult to justify the fourth order. We are working at the second order, inequality assertion on that sort. But if you allow for wealth sharing, if you say that sharing random shocks among individuals is better than concentrating it on one person, then this kind of assumption becomes available. You can use this well-known theorem, which is you have a first-order term of stochastic dominance with some boundary condition here, which are less important. Okay. But this theorem is known. It's just that now we can use it because we have an interpretation. And this is probably the most interesting, and I'm going to almost conclude on that. Where you have all the conditions that you can justify. This is a class of utilities where you concentrate all your hypotheses about the fact that your social planner has some test for sharing shocks in society, at least in the sense that I have described. So, in that case, okay, I'm going to move over the technical things.
can also translate it into all these results. You can translate it in poverty orderings, which are generalization of the Foster Greek Forbes poverty ordering with several arguments. You see, here you have the coefficients which are called alpha in a unidimensional setting, and you have equivalence of all these results with poverty orderings, which I don't have time to discuss, but here that